Because our minds are constantly disturbed from our mental activity, our thoughts, our sensory impressions, our dreams, our imaginations. If we learn to focus the mind on a divine name, on a divine mantra like Om, if we learn to give our main mental attention to that, then it starts to dominate the mental field. It will even begin to permeate into the subconscious mind, so that when we sit quietly to meditate or to think, the mantra will come up. So cultivating the power of attention and sattvic awareness through mantra is a very important key, it's a very important tool, method. One could do a whole program, whole months, years of study. Go into that, it's something very simple that anybody can begin with. But we should also look at it in a practical way. Whatever is our dominant thought determines our state of mind. And if our dominant thought is dominated by rajas, you know, what am I going to get, where am I going to go, what am I going to achieve, or if it's dominated by tamas, you know, I just want to sleep, I don't want to do anything, leave me alone, etc., we can see what's happening. Those gunas will be increased. But if our dominant thought has sattva-guna, then it's going to be thoughts that are for greater upliftment, deeper awareness, helping, connecting, healing. So the mantra, which is the energization of sattvic thoughts and sattvic words, divine names, it works very importantly to bring sattva-guna into the mind. Now, relative to yoga, traditional yoga is also very much connected to devotion, or bhakti in Sanskrit. Even the classical text on yoga, the Yoga Sutras of Patanjali, mentions Ishvara Pranidhana, which is the principle of devotion to the divine, as perhaps the prime principle of yoga practice, but certainly a central and dominant principle of all forms of yoga. And what that means is aligning ourselves at a heart level with the divine consciousness that pervades the universe. That consciousness we can approach in terms of many names and forms. There are many aspects of divinity that are expressed through various devatas, gods, goddesses, avatars, incarnations. In the Hindu tradition, it's a very rich tradition, so it's accepted over time many names and forms of God, many great teachers, many saviors, prophets, avatars. So because of that, there's many forms. The important thing is that is not the particularities of the form, but using a form to approach the divine with devotion, with attention. And in that regard, devotion is one of the prime tools of cultivating sattva-guna, and it's one of the most important tools for everyone, because devotion is something that is accessible to all of us. Even in the Western religions, they're based primarily on faith and devotion. Faith, devotion of some kind is common to all religions. But when we talk about sattva-guna, we're cultivating a faith that embraces all people, that does not exclude anyone based upon their religious belief, that honors the divine presence not only in all human beings, but in all nature. So it is not a principle of devotion as a dogma or a particular theology, that even though these may be helpful to some people at some time, it is a principle of devotion as a universal feeling, linking everyone together under the interdependence of life and the interdependence of consciousness and the divine consciousness that is pervading all of life and that is the basis of the soul and the mind in living creatures. First thing about cultivating sattva-guna, we must remain humble. Because we always, in our human nature, we have a lot of rajas and tamas anyway. If one of us happens to miraculously not have much of these, our friends and neighbors and family will provide plenty of it, so we will be exposed to it anyway. So I think whatever our state, we need to cultivate the sattva-guna. At the same time, the cultivation of sattva-guna, we need to make it into something natural and even something we might say interesting. It is not, again, it's not a matter of something puritanical or something rigid. So I attempt to follow a sattvic diet. I do follow a vegetarian diet. I try to avoid all the junk food, the fast food. Again, I'm not a puritanical, so there may be certain circumstances, traveling with friends. We don't need to become overly rigid. It's always the predominance of what we do. But the sattvic diet is something I hold to very closely, also because I work as an Ayurvedic doctor, and we want to cultivate a sattvic diet, so also be able to help benefit our patients. If I'm going to be trying to heal a patient, I want to make sure I'm not taking meat, because I feel I also want to have, as not just as a person, but as an Ayurvedic or as a healer, Ayurvedic doctor, I want to be able to project that healing energy that I can't do. So in that regard, I'll probably be stricter about diet than other people may in cultivating the gunas. Daily, I try to do some pranayama, mantra, and meditation. If not in the morning, then at least in the evening before I go to sleep. Because it's very important that we go to sleep with a sattvic mind. During the day, the gunas may get disturbed. Our rajas may come up, we may get angry, our tamas may come up, we may get dull. But it's important that when we go to sleep, we are in a clear, calm state of mind in which we have digested our day's experience and are projecting positive energies, intentions for the coming day. The pranayama is also good to do daily, maybe 15, half an hour, minutes in the morning or in the evening. Not only for sattva guna, but to keep the movement of prana going in the body, keep the mind energized, and to prevent the tamas, you know, inertia, from forming, whether at a physical level or a psychological level. Mantra, it's good to have a mantra that you are connected to, that you hold to, whether a single mantra like Om or Hrim or Shrim, or whether a particular prayer or extended mantra like the Gayatri. And to do that either along with meditation or, say, during the day, you're feeling dull, you're feeling distressed, you're feeling disturbed, remember the mantra. Use the mantra to stabilize the sattva guna. Another thing I try to do to increase sattva guna is to spend time in nature or around natural things. To walk out in the garden, to take a hike out into nature, to take a walk in the park, to open up to space. There's more sattva guna in space and nature. One of the rules we have is the mind tends to imitate its environment. And so if you're in an office all day long, if you're in the four walls of a room, even in a house all day long, the mind tends to get rigid, the mind tends to get disturbed, the rajas and the tamas comes up. If we go out into space, into nature, then we can release any negative energy into the trees, into the air, into the space, into the sky. So I try to do that daily, if not daily, at least sometimes a week. If I'm in the city, there's always a park in the house. You can have flowers. It's very important in that regard, and cultivating the sattva guna, to cultivate sattva guna in your environment, which means to have a house where there's flowers, where there's nice colors, where there's pictures of deities, you know, saints, holy people, where there's nice views, where there's space, where you can use things like incense, where you can bring the elevating forces, aesthetic forces, even artistic beauty into the house. In the Hindu practice, another way of creating sattva guna is the use of rituals. And there are two types of rituals that are done. One is what is called the puja. And in the puja, usually some representational form of the deity is used, a statue, a picture. But sattvic things are offered, flowers, incense, fragrant oils, sweet food, a ghee lamp, or a candle symbolizing five elements, five sensory essences. And then there'll be mantra, meditation, chanting, singing, devotional songs. These also increase the sattva guna. And the second form is the yajna, the fire offering. This may have to be done outside. You may have a special room in the house to do that, to make certain offerings. And the Vedic thought, which as you find in all ancient traditions, all native traditions, fire is the messenger between the human world and the divine. Fire is the place where we can concentrate, where we can purify. So to offer sattvic or pure substances into the fire, you know, wood, fragrant oils, fragrant spices, the samagri, which includes also various herbs. In Indian thought, there's also the use of the cow dung, which is thought to have a purifying effect, is also another way. In fact, the fire energy can also purify the environment. It creates the smoke, the burning up. It also has that abilities. There are also rituals that we can do. I don't do those rituals every day, but I do those rituals at certain occasions or in certain circumstances. I even use my fireplace for fire offerings in the winter. I should say my wood-burning stove. I don't actually have a fireplace. We also are building an outdoor fire pit to make outdoor fire offerings. I have a number of statues that I use, and one in particular I use more for ritualistic purposes, but I always like to keep flowers around them, burn incense, ghee lamps around them, and put lights around them so that we have some form in the house to welcome the divine presence. You know, the divine is the guest. So have the form is there not because we're worshiping a form, but we're using something to represent them, to allow their energy to come in, to honor them. Say, with your family, your parents, or your children, you're in a position where you can't see them physically. You will at least put up their pictures, some memento for them to hold their energy of form. So these are some of the things I do and some of the things that can be done. Gunas are a way we understand nature. The gunas are a way we learn to adapt to life. So it means like learning to flow like water, you know, learning to have the expansiveness of the wind, learning to be open like space. I'm emphasizing this point because it's not a rigid thing of black and white and do this and don't do that. So we need to create a flow of sattva guna in our lives. Now in the beginning we may need to follow more rigid rules. You may watch very carefully who we're associating with, what kind of shows we're watching, what kind of food we're eating. But it's an inner flow that is the most important thing with the gunas. And